We're at the Capitol Records Tower here in Hollywood. It was built in 1956 to resemble a stack of records. And you can explain to your kids what records were. But back in the 50s and 60s, this was the artistic home of the greatest recording stars of that era. And foremost among them was Frank Sinatra.
I've got you under my skin.
Frank Sinatra's legacy lives in his music, in his son Frank Sinatra Jr., and in this historic recording studio, a room that still bears Sinatra's classic microphone and recording chair.
I was here when the first record was made in this chamber. I was sitting here on top of this old linoleum floor, and the floors weren't even in then. That was February of 1956.
Do you remember what the recording was?
The recording was a Frank Sinatra record album in which he was conducting, not singing, a compilation of short pieces for orchestra called Tone Poems of Color.
I have this imagined picture in my mind of your dad going out into the hall and bumping into Dean Martin and, you know, Nat Cole comes bringing donuts for everybody.
That happened everywhere. Dean Martin was easy to bump into. His gait was not always, shall we say, accurate.
Is that true?
Oh, Dean toasted people's good health now and again. He was something.
Dean, Nat, and of course, Frank. Even today, their iconic presence is felt throughout Capitol Records.
It appears like they're in their Sunday best to come to work.
No, that's the way people dress then. Flip-flops had not been invented.
Capitol and Reprise Records are combining their Sinatra libraries, saluting one of the world's greatest performers with a career-spanning CD, Sinatra Best of the Best.
If you had to say, in a broad brush, how the Capitol years are sort of different from the Reprise years, what would you say?
The Capitol years is very simple. The Capitol years were 1950s. It was a different world in the 1950s than it became in the 1960s. All of a sudden now, we get into what then became known as rock and roll, all of it consummated in capital letters by someone named Elvis Presley, and then something else happened. Suddenly, we fell victim to what was called then the British invasion. Suddenly, we have the Beatles. And everybody said at the time, what are people like Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and Ella Fitzgerald and Nat King Cole, what are they gonna do for music? So they had to have their staffs begin to look harder and deeper to find the better music. One day I was sitting with Mr. Sinatra, and I said, why don't you make albums anymore like the Only the Lonely album? That was really such a great record. And he said it was a different world then.
I should mention that Only the Lonely is my favorite Sinatra album.
Cheers, mine too. That was made in this room.
Was it really?
Oh yeah.
So deep in my heart that you're really a part of me.
Those of us who have lost a parent or someone, or we go through the house and we find photographs occasionally and you get that little flutter in your heart. And you walk through this world where your dad's records are playing all the time. Do you become immune to that a little bit?
Not at all. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
I was his musical director for the last 7 years that he was giving concerts. On many occasions after the show, I had to go back to my room and change my shorts. The guys in the band used to say, he's a man who never does anything the same way once. We would be traveling the world. I think it was Yokohama, Japan. And this is a huge indoor arena that probably seats upwards of 70,000, 80,000 people. I was in the pit with the orchestra, and we got down to the end of the program when I threw the downbeat for My Way. And all through the room, you'd hear this low return. I did it my way. It would be coming from 75 or 80,000 throats. They may not understand the language well, that they knew. And he would turn, he would hear this, and he'd look at me at them, and he'd look at me and he'd smile. He couldn't believe it.
I just think what a privilege that must have felt like to be able to spend that time with your father.
Those 7 years that I was with him, they went by like 7 weeks. And one night on the stage, parents will never be able to keep from being parents. He decided one night he was going to introduce me to the audience. He said, "Our conductor is someone very close to me. This is my son, Francis." And all the musicians went. And I said, "What?" And he turned around and everybody in the audience laughed. And I went, I gave it to Don Rickles. And one night he said, "I want you to meet my conductor. It was almost as good as Lawrence Welk. Almost." And I looked at him, I said, "Now you hurt me. You cut me to the quick." And you asked me, do I get immune to it? No, it is touching. Yeah.
If there's any truth to the butterfly effect, that a vibrating wing in Central Park can start a typhoon in the South Pacific, then the vibes that came out of this building in the 1950s and 60s changed the way the world listened to music. And if you listen very carefully, you might hear the echoes of Frank Sinatra and the people who made that all possible. For my generation, I'm Blue Eyes Bill Newcott.